Growing up, I grew up in church. It was a pretty big mainstay in my day-to-day life. My dad was a youth pastor for as long as I can remember. I had multiple people in my family that were in full-time ministry, and just any opportunity that I had, I was in church, and that's where, you know, I had a lot of friends, and that's where my community before was, and it's really where I felt, you know, at home. Well, my dad was the person that he lit up any room that he walked into. So, like, my dad's my hero. Without him, like, I don't know where I would be to this day, because I don't know if there is a better example of how to live like Jesus than he was, just because he did it so consistently every day, and he was just so full of love. When I was 17, it was Christmas Day, and I remember telling my dad, like, this was the best Christmas that we've ever had. Like, I never expected that night would be the day that, like, I would have to say goodbye. And he passed away from a heart attack. Losing my dad really changed the trajectory of my life. It really pushed me and confused me, because, you know, it's not a natural thing for a 17-year-old to, you know, say goodbye to the person that is supposed to be his, you know, spiritual leader and the leader of his family. When my dad passed away, I moved schools, and my granddad was a pastor at the time, so I had to leave the church family that I had grown up with my whole life and move to a new church, and so everything was just like spinning. I met a girl at the new church. You know, we dated for 4.5 years, and I was trying to give every ounce of my being to her and trying to just please her with my actions, and she broke up with me after 4.5 years. It sounds kind of crazy to say, but that was a harder time in my life than when my dad passed away. Because with my dad passing away, like, you can't really blame anything, because it's not like he had a choice. It's different when somebody looks at you and says, I know where you're going, I know where you've been, I don't want to be a part of that anymore. And that wrecked me. About a year after that relationship ended, I was probably in the darkest part of my life. I was dealing with a lot of depression and anxiety, and I just felt really, really lonely. And I met this girl that I was working with at the time, and she invited me to Westridge. It was the beginning of a really, really good time in my life. I've been attending Westridge for about 6 months with a group of friends, and that's when one of my friends told me about small groups. And he invited me to his group, and it was literally the best choice that I've ever made. I was really hesitant about it at first, because I was a pretty introverted person, and I went in saying, oh, I'll probably make a couple friends, but like, I've met like my family. Like, those guys are my brothers, and like, I love them all so much. And I know that they love me, and that's something that I could never repay, because like, I don't know where I would be if I never met them, if God didn't intervene and bring these men into my life to say, no, you have a purpose here. And that truth is something that's kept me going over the past couple years, and it's something that I'm just eternally grateful for. The enemy wants you to feel like you're by yourself, because that diminishes the impact that you have. I encourage you to get into a group and don't hold back, because I sat in group for a year without ever speaking, and those people didn't know the things that I was going through, and in reality, like, there was not much life change in that moment. It was the moment when I started sharing the things that I was dealing with and the issues that were going on in my life where Christ really received power and glory through my story. It's a good thing to be in church on a Sunday morning, but there's not much accountability in that. You can sit in a chair and listen, and you could walk out those doors and change nothing about your life, and then you can come back on a Sunday. That's not the goal. We want to see people living lives like they believe that they are chosen and that they are precious to the God that created them. When you get into that room where people are looking at you and they're calling you out on things, and it might not feel great in the moment, but it's necessary because people see things that you don't see, and they're able to speak over you in those times. Like, I feel like that's the power of a small group, and that's what I challenge people to find, because once you find it, you'll never want to go back, because you experience the freedom of what that brings, of saying, I have nothing else hidden.